if there's any doubt that solid-state batteries are actually here, well, here's proof. Or is it? Future Matt interjecting here. Now, this is a republication of a video that I originally published on July 16th. Now, I've unlisted that video and linked to it in the description below. But this version has some additional notes I'll be dropping in as we go in this new version. The reason? Well, shortly after I published my initial review of the Yoshino solid-state battery pack that I bought for myself on Amazon, some people left comments that the company Tech Insights had published a report saying it wasn't solid-state technology after all, after they broke it down and tested it. However, when I looked at the free report that Tech Insights made available, it raised more questions than it answered. So I reached out to them to start my own investigation, as well as to Yoshino for comment. Now, I'm going to be publishing a follow-up video on my investigation later, but didn't want to leave the original video up without noting those issues. I'll be popping in again to highlight those issues, but keep all of this in mind as you watch, because there's some serious potential issues with how Yoshino is marketing the battery pack. But back to the video. You can actually buy this for yourself like I did and get it delivered to your door in a day or two. No, solid-state batteries aren't everywhere and definitely not mass market yet, but they aren't vaporware and always 5 years away. Just like this Yoshino battery, which I'll get into the details in just a second, there's other solid-state batteries right on the cusp of ending up in consumer electronics devices near you. But do these early versions live up to the hype? And who is this Yoshino battery really good for? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Ground News, but more on that later. I published a video a few weeks back about the progress of solid-state batteries and how they're finally here. And to say I got some pushback would be an understatement. I received comments like, "Nuclear fusion has some company." It's really funny. It's not accurate, but it is funny. I'll give you that. Now, I guess I sparked quite a reaction. I really opened myself up to that point of view with how I talked about the latest developments. Everyone has a different opinion of what a product being here, as in now, means. Does it mean it's mass market, or just that it's the first cells that are shipping? It's a bit of a charged topic, and my focus on EVs didn't help that matter either. Bottom line, I could have done a much better job clearly defining what I meant by here and now in the video. Now, I'll amp up my clarity on that kind of stuff next time. But in a nutshell, I was talking about how many companies are now producing solid-state battery cells for actual use and/or testing by partners. We're officially in the manufacturing ramp-up stage, so figuring out the chemistry and if it works is kind of in the rearview mirror in some cases. That is a major milestone and a sign that the technology has hit a turning point. It's definitely a positive change. However, I should have focused on a product that you can actually get in your hands today, or to quote another comment from the video, until I can order from Amazon, it's not even close. So please, no solid-state information unless it's in your possession. Okay, here you go. I bought myself this Yoshino B330 solid-state portable power station on Amazon and had it delivered to my house in 2 days. And to be clear, I have no relationship with Yoshino. This is the smallest version of their battery pack, which has 330 watts of continuous power and 241 watt-hours of storage. They also have a version that scales all the way up to the B4000, which has 4,000 watts of continuous power and 2,611 watt-hours of storage capacity. In general, the reason you might want a small battery like the B330 is for going camping or reserving emergency power to charge up your phone or laptop in a blackout. The larger batteries are also great for those same uses, but they're even better for running power tools at a work site that doesn't have power available, or backing up more substantial appliances in a blackout, or even getting your entire home back online. Now, the little guy I have right here weighs in at 9.9 pounds and can charge in a couple of hours. What's nice to see on even a small unit like this is that you can charge through one of three ways. One, the DC input on the back, two, solar panels, and three, USB-C power delivery on the front. You can also tandem these up to speed up the charging, so you can be charging through both the USB-C and DC or solar input on the back all at the same time. There's a couple of DC output terminals on the front, as well as two AC outlets, two USB-A, and two USB-C ports. The main focus of Yoshino for this design is meant for on-the-go power, like as an emergency backup or for use during camping trips, so there's an LED light bar that can act as a light source. Now, it's not the brightest light in the world, but in a pinch, it's a nice thing to have. And much like other battery packs in this type of product, you can also connect to it through an app via Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. And this allows you to install firmware updates and to control it remotely. It's not an earth-shattering app, but it is well-designed and easy to navigate. It shows you what ports are currently active, the power draw, and how much time is left on the current charge. You can also monitor its charging status, which can be handy when you've got some solar panels plugged into it. So what's inside this thing? Well, it's a solid state cell that's using an NCM or nickel cobalt manganese formula, which might sound similar to the widely used NMC or nickel manganese cobalt. The reason for the different order of the letters usually reflects the different ratios of those elements in the chemistry for the battery cathode. Now, the big difference though is the use of a solid electrolyte versus a liquid or gel version. For Yoshino, they're using an inorganic polymer composite or IPC for their electrolyte between the anode and the cathode. I reached out to Yoshino for additional details on the battery and found out some interesting things. The team didn't give me the exact formulation of their battery for probably obvious reasons, but did share details of the safety testing done by USA Energy Assurance Labs. Yoshino's batteries were put through the paces for thermal runaway, nail penetrations, and short circuits, which are some of the big selling points of solid-state batteries. This battery is substantially safer in those regards than a typical lithium-ion battery with a liquid electrolyte. Okay, Future Matt is back. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, Tech Insights found a large amount of liquid inside the battery cell when they broke it open, which is the primary reason they concluded that it's not solid state, for obvious reasons. Now, Yoshino is still standing behind their claim and points to their use of an IPC solid electrolyte. There are research papers into IPCs for solid state batteries that show it's a potential viable path, but the amount of liquid that Tech Insights found raises big questions about all of Yoshino's claims. I shared those claims with the Tech Insights team, so they're going to go back and do some more testing to fill in some of the gaps that I raised in their initial report. In fact, by the time you're seeing this, that test is already done. I'm also working with a fellow YouTuber and friend of mine to do his own breakdown and analysis of the battery. He's a PhD student at a university and has all the lab equipment to do all the stuff that he needs to do, which should be underway by the time that you see this video. Now, I'm really eager to see if we find the same exact thing that Tech Insights did or not. As soon as that follow-up video is available, I'll be linking to it in the description of this video. It's taking some time to pull all of it together because I want to make sure I have as much information and facts as possible for an informed answer. There's also some other key attributes that set this battery apart that shouldn't be a surprise if you're familiar with solid state. They're more energy dense, which means you can get the same power output and storage in a smaller package. They're also better on the cycle life front too, so these should last longer than the competition that's out there. But how's this look in context? And context is super important when looking at technologies like this, as well as all of your news stories. Misinformation and bias shows up in all reporting, which is why I'm excited to have Ground News as a sponsor. Created by a former NASA engineer, the Ground News app and website gathers news from over 50,000 sources in one place and allows you to compare the coverage and get context into those sources themselves. Every story comes with a breakdown of the political bias and how reliable the source's reporting practices are, all backed by ratings from three independent news monitoring organizations. For instance, this recent story about a couple of people accused of stealing Tesla battery secrets to start their own company. You can quickly see how many total sources covered this story, out of which 52% lean left, 43% center, and only 5% lean right. Best of all, you can compare headlines to see how these biases might affect the framing. This right source leans into the country of origin and the definitive word stole as fact, while this left source doesn't mention nationality at all and uses the word accused, which means it hasn't been settled as fact yet. I love being able to access different viewpoints to make sure I'm not living in an echo chamber, which makes their blind spot feed my favorite feature. It highlights stories that are underreported by one side of the political spectrum. And Ground News has become an essential resource for me to make sure that I'm seeing the nuance in different stories and not just one source's perspective. Go to ground.news/undecided or scan the QR code to give it a try. If you sign up through my link, you'll get 40% off the Vantage plan, which is what I use to get unlimited access to all the features. I think Ground News is doing important work, and I hope you'll check them out. Thanks to Ground News and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to how the Yoshino battery looks in context. This is where we should compare the Yoshino battery to comparable power stations on the market. And some of the more popular brands out there are things like Blue Eddy, Anker, and EcoFlow. So let's take a look at some of those. And since I have the Yoshino B330, let's compare it to similar sized batteries like the EcoFlow River 2, Blue Eddy EB3A, and Anker 522. When you look at the price, it looks like it falls right in line with the competition. However, when you divide the cost of the unit by the watt hour capacity, you start to see the difference. Yoshino is roughly $1.24 per watt hour, while the others chime in between 90 cents and $1.12 per watt hour. That means Yoshino's battery, which is a first gen product, comes in 11 to 37% more costly than the competition per watt hour. However, the key benefits of solid state is safety, longevity, and energy density. So how does it compare on that last one? Well, not so great for the model that I've got. Yoshino is at 53.56 watt hours per kilogram, which is just slightly lower than the Blue Eddy. but both EcoFlow and Anchor have 73 and 76 watt hours per kilogram. So what's going on there? This made no sense to me. So I decided to expand my comparison to Yoshino's largest battery, the B4000, to comparable batteries. I picked the EcoFlow Delta Pro, the Blue Eddy AC300B300 combo, and Anchor Solix F3800. This is where it got more perplexing. Okay, back again. A bunch of people took issue with how I broke down the watt hours per kilogram in my review. In this video, my intent was to review and look at the Yoshino battery from a user experience perspective. That means the final product that you have in hand and will be picking up, tossing into the back of your car and lugging around. The watt hours per kilogram of the actual battery cells isn't important from that perspective. That's why I did the watt hours based on the product weight and product cost. I still stand by that, but wanted to call that out. In the follow-up investigation video, I'll be getting into all the battery cell details. Now, these models aren't exactly an apples-to-apples comparison because of how they're intended to be used. The Blue Eddy AC300B300 combo is actually two separate boxes that you have to use together. It's meant more for permanent or semi-permanent insulation like whole home backup or for an RV. Now, in terms of power output and storage though, it is comparable, which is why I picked it. Money-wise, the numbers across the board landed in a very similar region, at least when non-sale prices were used for comparison. The Yoshino clocked in between 21 and 29% more expensive than the competitors. It's not shocking, but the watt hours per kilogram was very different. The Yoshino B4000 has 107 watt hours per kilogram versus a range of 53 to 80 watt hours per kilogram. That makes the B4000 101% more energy dense than the comparable Blue Eddy and 34% more energy dense than the EcoFlow. And this is more of what I was expecting to see when I dove into this comparison in the first place. So why is this smaller battery, the one that I've got, so behind in the comparison? And my hunch was the physical design of the product and all the bells and whistles. Yoshino's battery has a large and heavy metal handle that wraps around the entire box. EcoFlow's River 2, on the other hand, is all plastic with no light, which means there is a weight savings from materials and components. This hunch was confirmed when I reached out to Yoshino for more information. The team compromised some additional weight for the sake of additional functionality and aesthetics. Okay, another reason, which could be obvious given the controversy, is that if this is not a true solid-state battery, then you're not going to see a massive difference in watt hours per kilogram. However, it's also worth noting that just using a solid-state electrolyte doesn't automatically double or triple your specific energy. Yoshino's claims have always been around using a solid electrolyte, but the chemistry of their anode and cathode isn't novel. They're not using a lithium metal or anode-less design like QuantumScape. If they're telling the truth about their solid-state setup, that could explain why their anode and cathode chemistry is better than the lithium iron phosphate competition, but not that different from what we normally see in a nickel manganese cobalt battery, which is what they claim to have. Again, I'll have a full breakdown on the report when we have everything pulled together. Having one in hand, I can say it's nice to pick up and it looks great, but I'd personally have preferred a plastic casing to save some weight. However, those design choices become less impactful as you scale up the battery pack size, which is why we see the B4000 come out way ahead on that front. All of that raises the big question, why would you want this? Well, it really comes down to your use case. So let's start with the small battery packs. If you're looking for the lightest weight and cheapest small battery pack to take with you on a trip, then you're most likely looking at the EcoFlow or the Anchor. However, if you're looking for a battery that will last you an incredible time span with the least degradation, is also exceptionally safe and can work in a wide range of temperatures without concern, then you're probably looking at the Yoshino. In this small size category though, it's a tough sell. So what about the larger battery format? Well, many of the same arguments hold true here, but this is where the weight comes into play. If you need a largest battery that you can get to easily toss into the back of your truck or RV for a trip, even though the Yoshino B4000 costs more, it's dramatically lighter weight. It's half to one third the weight of the competition. Lugging a 53-pound or 24-kilogram battery onto the back of your truck sounds way more appealing than a 100 to 130-pound or 57 to 60-kilogram battery. On top of that, the Yoshino will have a longer lifespan and is safer too. However, if you're looking for a battery that could serve as a whole home backup with a semi-permanent installation, Yoshino isn't even on the table. Its current batteries are designed for a lifestyle type of brand, on-the-go uses, camping, and emergency backups. There is an elephant in the room though. Many of the companies like Blue Eddy, EcoFlow, and Anchor have massive sales and promotions that drive that cost even further down. If you pick up their batteries on sale, there's no contest for the value that you get. In that case though, it's important to remember one thing. This is the first gen Yoshino battery. There's no doubt they're working on a second generation product that should be cheaper and more competitive on that front. The next crop of batteries should also be even more compelling on the energy density and performance front too. That said, for a first gen product, I think the Yoshino holds up surprisingly well. As I always point out when looking at any product, it all comes down to your personal use case. That will dictate what features are more important to you and could make the slight increase in cost acceptable. I'm very impressed with the build quality and performance I saw in my testing, and I'm really eager to see where Yoshino goes from here. Okay, my final reminder here, I'm gonna be publishing a full report on my investigation into Tech Insights report, their additional testing they did based on my conversation with them, my friend's breakdown of the battery for another point of view, all of it. So check the description for a link for that video if it's already published, or subscribe and hit the notification button so you don't miss it when it's published. I also have to thank all the folks who pointed me in the direction of Tech Insights. As rowdy as some of you guys can be in the comments, again, please be polite and debate the ideas, not the person. I learn a lot from everybody in the comments. I'm really looking forward to sharing the follow-up. And of course, if Yoshino's solid-state claims can't be backed up, they could be pulling a fast one on all of us. I hope that's not the case. But in the meantime, I can't recommend that you get any of their products until the picture is truly clear. As much as I actually like the product that I bought for myself, if the marketing is making false claims, that kills it right there for me. But until I complete my investigation, I'm trying to keep an open mind, or should I say, remain undecided. More to come. But what do you think? What portable batteries are your favorite and why? And does seeing an actual solid-state battery like this on the market give you any hope for the future of solid-state? Jump into the comments and let me know, and be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where we'll keep this conversation going. Thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support. I'll see you in the next one.